Now we are considering the function of interest. Interests are the purposes participants bring to meaning and the cross purposes in their interaction. Interests, of course, can involve different roles, not just human interests, but things such as nature as well as sentient creatures in the role of animate self or other. Interests can be expressed rhetorically in programs that push towards sameness or difference, or in a seemingly objective world that has been constituted by a process we call reification. Patterns of sociability are expressed in antagonistic and solidary interests. The universe of interests is in a state of perpetual flux where we can parse its movement, and finally, through this parsing of these movements, we can make changes. We will focus now on rhetoric. Rhetoric is direct and explicit appeal. Advertising is rhetoric. Political speeches are rhetoric. A conversation where a parent is trying to convince a child they should do something is rhetoric. A dog's bark even is rhetoric. Most theories of rhetoric are based on a transmission model of communication. Rhetoric is the business of successfully getting your message across. In this conventional view, rhetoric is a linear process where a message goes from a rhetor who wishes to persuade to a recipient who may or may not be persuaded, depending on the effectiveness of the rhetor in expressing their interests. We have a quite different view of rhetoric though. It is not about message transmission where the recipient ideally takes on board the rhetor's persuasive views. It is about their enduring differences. It is not about successful communication in this sense. It is a dialectic where these differences play themselves through in transpositions between representation, communication, and interpretation. Here's an advertisement. Catch this fast train, it is saying, in 1938. That is, if we look at the poster with an understanding of rhetoric that has a focus on communication. Rhetor and recipient reach a shared meaning when the recipient agrees they might catch this train. This is the linear shared meaning of communication. In our view, however, the interests of the New York Central Company and the interests of the viewer are always different. And that is precisely the reason for the rhetoric. Their interests can never be aligned because they were never meant to be. Also, there is no meaning without interpretation, and this will be as varied as interpreters and their context. Looking at this advertisement today, you might say, nice train, pity it was cancelled forever in 1967. Something about the rhetoric still works if you like the poster, but this interpretation would have been inconceivable for the poster maker.
And now, two kinds of rhetoric, open and closed. To illustrate this, we're going to take you into two museums. Here's an exhibit on display at the National Museum of Australia in Canberra. It's called Love Wheels by Eloise Murphy, a member of a guerrilla crochet group. She created this work at the time of a national referendum on marriage equality. She tied it to a post outside the Prime Minister's house. In the referendum, 61% voted yes, 38% voted no. The National Museum of Australia is heavily curated with not too many objects, just representative samples of things it considers, to use its own words, compelling. Panels of text on the wall tell the museum goer what they should be thinking and what they should be seeing. A single object was therefore placed to represent the marriage equality referendum. But in a sense, this is closed rhetoric because it doesn't leave much space for the 38% who voted no. Not that this is necessarily a bad thing. Marriage equality is now the law, and the 38% better get used to it. Our point here simply is that this is closed rhetoric, and at times there may be a place for that. Now we are in the former Imperial Museum in Calcutta, opened in 1875 during the heyday of British rule. Now it's called the Indian Museum, but it feels that not much has changed since the museum was opened. There's a room full of birds in stuffed cases. There's a room full of minerals, a room full of fossils, a room full of Buddhas, and apparently over 100,000 items by the time you've been the whole way through. There are tiny labels beside each of the objects, but not much explanatory text. Ironically, perhaps, this is a more open text than the National Museum of Australia, because it gives the visitor more space to make whatever sense they wish, the incredible range of native birds in India, the consistencies and changes in the representation of Buddhas, striking rare minerals, whatever. And there's just too much to find everything that's interesting. We have to make our own way depending on our own interests. But like all museums, the design is rhetorical. It's just that it's rhetorical in a very different way from the National Museum of Australia. Here are just a few of the ways in which closed versus open rhetorics are expressed across the different forms of meaning. Some textual genres, for example, are relatively closed, others more open. Realistic images leave less space for interpretation than abstract images. Both are rhetorical, but in these quite different ways.